next topic. Anticoagulants and regional anesthesia. Every other patient nowadays which is coming up for surgery is receiving some kind of anticoagulant, because coronary artery disease is an epidemic in our country and almost every other patient is on some anticoagulant. So this topic is going to be covered by Dr. Pankaj Gupta. I'm very happy to introduce him to you because he's our my own department's past student and has been very, very aggressive, very, very actively interested in the pain relief procedures right from his residency days. His CV goes a long way, but I would just tell him that he's a leading practitioner in Nasik and he has worked a lot as IMA president, has got lots of social activities and has been the a member of the team for the first angioplasty in Nasik and is mainly involved in neurosurgery, spine surgery, so I'm sure that he's having a lot of experience as far as this topic is concerned. And I request Dr. Pankaj Gupta to deliver his lecture.
Thank you, madam. In fact, I find it a great privilege on my behalf to see that someone who has taught you what you are today is chairing this session. I'm really happy about it, madam. Thank you. Anticoagulation and interventional procedures. I'll start off with saying that my aim of my talk will be to give a proper take-home message. The different protocols are availing in different countries, and the guidelines are quite specific. Only, unfortunately, they are very different in every association in every country. So I hope that at the end of it, I can maybe give a proper take-home message, and also a little bit about emergency reversal if required for interventions can be covered in this talk. I have to have a disclaimer because it is difficult to accept the liability or responsibility from errors that may occur from the use of this information. As I said, different guidelines are practiced in different countries. Anticoagulants, as we know, are widely used in treating atrial fibrillation, CAD, deep vein thrombosis, ischemic stroke, myocardial infarction, pulmonary embolism, restenosis from stents, and so many other indications today. But the basic idea behind it is to prevent formation of dangerous clots, and we don't want their growth to increase. So the major complication that we've come across related to anticoagulation is bleeding. This bleeding can be very dangerous, especially when it is intraspinal or intracranial. The factors that increase the risk of a major bleed depends a lot on the intensity of the anticoagulant effect, increasing age, females are found to be most susceptible to the actions of anticoagulants, use of concomitant drugs like aspirin. The patient may have a history of GI bleed, and of course the duration of treatment is also as important. The epidural space, as we all know, is a closed area, and it is richly supplied with a venous plexus, which is more often the cause of the bleeding in the epidural space. And if there is bleeding, it can result in cord compression, ischemia, nerve damage, and paralysis being a non-expandable compartment. Whereas if bleeding does occur in the intrathecal space, it gets diluted by the CSF, and that's why the effects are usually less devastating. The incidence of epidural hematoma formation in routine cases has been anything from 1.1 in 1.5 lakhs to 1.9 lakhs, whereas in spinal anesthesia it has been something like 1.2.2 lakhs. Whereas patients who have on anticoagulants, the incidence goes up as much as 33 in 1 lakh for epidurals and 1 in 1 lakh for spinals. The risk factors are the anatomic abnormalities of the spinal cord and vertebral column. Person-to-person variation is always there. There may be some other vascular abnormalities. There may be pathological induced alterations because of other drugs. Alcohol is an important cofactor. Chronic renal insufficiency. And of course, if the needle placement has been difficult or the epidural catheter removal may have its problems. The signs and symptoms of an epidural hematoma, yes, the patient does present with a low back pain, sharp and irradiating, may have sensory and motor loss, and may be accompanied with a blood and bowel dysfunction, and ultimately can lead to paraplegia. So that's why immediate treatment and management is very important. The treatment has to be diagnosed in the first 8 to 12 hours for it to have a proper recovery. The main diagnostic tool is the MRI, and the patient has to undergo a decompressive laminectomy in case you want the paraplegia to reverse. There have been instances and the paraplegia has reversed even after a late diagnosis. So that becomes a very important thing. Coming to the guidelines, I feel, as I mentioned, the guidelines are very different in every association in every country. But fortunately, in the Regional Anesthesia and Pain Medicine Journal of June 2015, there was a huge article where the American Society came to got together six major associations that are mentioned in this slide. And they came out with specific guidelines. Most of my talk is going to be based on these guidelines, and of course, a few are different. The general recommendations that they have mentioned are avoid concurrent use of coagulation-altering medications, use opioids or dilute local anesthetic. I feel Ropucan has made our things a little easier to allow neurological examination for post-op analgesia when an epidural is inserted in a patient. It is best to remove the catheter at the nadir of the anticoagulant activity. No additional anticoagulant should be immediately given once the catheter is removed. The frequent evaluation of neurological status of the patient, even after the catheter has been removed, is very important for early diagnosis in susceptible patients. In high-risk cases, continue the monitoring at least for 24 hours after the catheter removal. What they did was they divided the procedures as high-risk procedures, intermediate-risk procedures, and low-risk procedures. The high-risk procedures are mainly those involving the spinal cord, and the intermediate procedures are basically the deep transforaminal blocks or maybe the deep sympathetic blocks. The low-risk procedures are the peripheral nerve blocks and the trigger point injections. These are going to be covered again and again when I give the recommendations. Well, coming to the list of anticoagulants, we all know that antiplatelets are the aspirin, the NSAIDs, the phosphodiesterase inhibitors, the thianopyridine derivatives, the platelet glycoprotein inhibitors, heparins, unfractionated or low molecular, vitamin K antagonists, warfarin, echinocumarol. A new drug of novel oral anticoagulant drugs has come up. These are more of direct acting anticoagulants, and they be divided as factor 2A inhibitors and factor 10A inhibitors. Thrombolytic and fibrinolytic medications can be a great disaster for if we have to give the patient some block. There are some herbal preparations which have been known to prolong the coagulation profile. And if the patient is on antidepressant or serotonin reuptake inhibitors, then it is good to associate of, the concerned treating doctor and accordingly plan the anticoagulation. Coming to each individual drug, the recommendations for aspirin, now the Astra had given a clear recommendation that aspirin can be continued till the last day of the procedure. But even then, it was found that there were patients who there were patients who did develop complications after a spinal or epidural. So now it has been clearly mentioned that if patients are on secondary prophylaxis, it is better to stop the drug for high-risk procedures for at least 6 days, for low-risk procedures for 4 days. And if the patient is taking 1 gram, then definitely preferable to stop for 1 week before the procedure. And of course, it can be started at 24 hours post-procedure. I personally am of the opinion that if the patient is taking something like 75 milligrams, because above 80 milligrams is where all these catastrophic problems can occur. So if the patient is on 75 milligrams aspirin, I feel you can very well continue the aspirin. NSAIDs, there is no need to really stop these drugs unless the patient has history of bruising easily, history of excessive bleeding. A female patient, as I said, is more susceptible, or a patient is an elderly patient. The phosphodiesterase inhibitors, it has been suggested that they should be discontinued for at least 48 hours before performing the intervention. The thianopyridine derivatives, yes, they are, their recommendations are quite specific. Clopidogrel or Plavix should be stopped for about 5 to 7 days, and it can be resumed within 12 to 24 hours. The first denominator will suggest the low-risk procedures, and 24 will suggest the high-risk procedures. Ticagrelor or Brilinta has to be stopped for 5 days, and it should be resumed after 24 hours. The prasugrel or Effient should be stopped about 7 to 10 days and can be resumed after 24 hours. Coming to the 2B3A inhibitors, these are basically drugs which are used during percutaneous coronary interventions by cardiologists, and especially for unstable angina. The recommendations for them are, their half-lives are pretty short actually. So abscisimab has just a short half-life of about 10 to 30 minutes. Platelet recovery has been found after in about 48 hours, but it has a very slow dissociation. So it has been recommended that you stop this drug at least for 8 to 12 hours before any intervention. Eptifibatide or antigrelin has to be stopped about 2.5 hours before any procedure, and because platelet recovery takes about 4 hours, and the interval between drug discontinuation and intervention is about 8 to 24 hours. And post-operative, the drug can be started about 8 to 12 hours. Tirofiban is another drug quite similar, 2 hours, 4 to 8 hours, 8 to 24 hours, and again 8 to 12. So eptofibatide and tirofiban are quite similar. Coming to the and of course the main thing is if the patient has after an interventional procedure, after a cardiologist has already done some procedure on the patient, and if the patient has to be given some block, it is definitely this anticoagulant is contraindicated within 4 weeks of the surgery. That's a very important thing which has come out. Vitamin K and anticoagulants, I feel all of us are used to warfarin. Onset is about 8 to 12 hours with a peak of 36 to 72 hours. Echinocamerol should be stopped for about 3 days. And the INR normalized before taking the patient for any high risk or intermediate procedure. Regarding warfarin, of course you have to confirm that the patient is not taking any other drug. Stop for 5 days. The PT-INR is very important to be checked before giving any neuraxial block. If the patient has received a dose of warfarin within 24 hours of the block, you need not do an INR, and the patient can be subjected because warfarin takes about 36 to 48 hours to act. But if the patient already 24 hours has passed, then it's very important to do a PT-INR. Patients receiving post-op epidural analgesia and warfarin should definitely have a PT-INR monitored every day. So you have to keep the level below at least 3. If the INR is above 3, the dose of warfarin should be withheld, and the catheter should be removed only when the INR goes below 1.5. If it is removed above 1.5, then the patient has to be monitored for the next 24 hours definitely. Heparin should be delayed for at least 1 hour after neuraxial block. Like if you've taken the patient up for surgery and the surgeon asks for heparin, please wait for 1 hour before administering the heparin. The catheter should be removed 2 to 4 hours after the last dose. And heparin can be reinitiated until 1 hour has passed after the procedure. If a bloody tap has occurred, it should be communicated to the surgeon. But today there are no specific data which suggests that the surgery should be cancelled. But definitely the patient requires more intensive monitoring. Regarding heparin, as I mentioned, IV heparin low dose, 4 hours is the time. The low risk procedures can be done after 2 to 4 hours, 2 to 24 hours. 2 to 24 hours, especially if there is a bloody tap. Otherwise, after 2 hours, there's no harm in having the procedure started. And 24 hours, after 24 hours, the drug can be resumed. Subcutaneous heparin has been quite controversial. It was suggested that a BD dose there's no harm in going in with a BD dose. But now it has been suggested that the interventional procedure can be the procedure can be performed when the patient is on subcutaneous heparin. But now it has been found that if the patient is having subcutaneous heparin, at least TDS dose, it's better to give the interventional procedure 2 hours after the procedure. For LNWH now, it's quite clear. You require for low dose, that is the diagnostic, the low dose can be given 12 hours, 12 hours and 12 hours. I remember it this way as 12, 12, 12. If it's a low dose molecular weight heparin. If it is a therapeutic dose, which in that case the interval has to be 24 hours, 24 hours, and 24 hours. These are the list of drugs that are used. Enoxaparin, I feel, is quite commonly used. When there is continuous epidural administration with low molecular weight heparins, the risk of hematoma formation has been found to be very high. Almost 1 in 3,000 for epidurals, whereas in spinal it has been almost 1 in 40,000. So it's probably much safer to give a spinal anesthesia when patient suspecting a problem. Bridging therapy, yes, low molecular weights have been routinely used for bridging therapy. Personally, recently I found heparin more convenient because you can just stop the last doses 4 to 6 hours before the procedure and go ahead with the heparin. Of course, the patient has to be admitted for that. So bridging therapy is very much there to stay. With heparin, I prefer heparin in the present day situation. This group of drugs is a new group which has come, the thrombin factor 2A inhibitors. They are more useful because they are more rapid, effective, predictable. They are less influenced by diet medications. They have a short half-life. And all of them except ergotropin are excreted through the kidneys. They also require less monitoring than warfarin. And they can be used in heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. Any patient on heparin has to have a confirmation of the platelet count because after four days, HIT is known to be prevalent. Whereas the only problem is they are more expensive. That's where the problem comes. Again, the list of drugs is dabigatran. It has a half-life of about 12 to 17 hours, and it should be stopped about 4 days if the patient does not have any renal disease, but 6 days if the patient has a renal disease. And it can be resumed about 6 hours after the procedure. Ergotropin has a half-life of 45 minutes. So it should be held for at least 3 hours before the procedure. And after the procedure, it can be resumed for 6 hours. Valiuretine has a half-life of 24 hours, and it can be given, it should be stopped 1.5 hours if the creatinine clearance is more than 30, and 3 hours if the creatinine clearance is less than 30. The other two drugs are really not being used. Fondaparinux is, again, a direct-acting 10A inhibitor. It has a half-life of 70 to 21 hours. It should be stopped 4 hours before the 4 days before the procedure, and can be resumed 6 hours after the procedure. Rivaroxaban, apixaban, and edoxaban have a half-life of about almost 9 hours plus. And they should be stopped 3 days before the procedure, and they can be resumed 24 hours after the procedure is over. Thrombolytics, it is suggested you withhold for 10 days. This herbal preparation I mentioned, they preferably should be stopped for about 5 to 7 days. Just a list of the, in case of emergency reversal, this is a list of the reversal that I found in case the patient has to be actually taken up. Antiplatelets can be reserved by RDP and SDPs. Heparin, we have the protamine sulfate, lifelong tested. Warfarin, you use injection vitamin K, FFP or PCC. PCC again can be a 4-factor or a 3-factor PCC. For 10 inhibitors, it can be reversed by andixanet alpha, but which is still on a trial basis. Dabigatran is the only NOAC which has a reversal. Idarucizumab, which requires a dose of about 5 grams. These are some of the references that I have gone through. Thank you.
Thank you, Pankaj. He has given even the latest information. Every day we are facing problems because of the explosion in the pharmaceutical industry where newer and newer agents are coming up. And we have to know what is the duration of these novel agents. Thank you for giving the details of that. One or two questions we can have. Thank you, Pankaj. Yes.
The epidural catheter be removed?
I did give the reference to it. Which was the drug you mentioned?
Rivaroxaban.
Rivaroxaban is a recommendation around 6 to 12 hours after the procedure.
So if the epidural catheter is in place, they should not start the rivaroxaban?
Or? No, it will depend on how long you want to keep the epidural catheter. If you plan to keep it for 2 to 3 days, you can start the anticoagulant. But after the catheter has been, see to it that the last dose has been given at least 6 hours before this one, okay. Removal catheter. And after the catheter has been removed, preferable to stop for around 6 to 8 hours. That is what is recommended. Actually, it's a very controversial topic. There are every association has given different recommendations for everything that I mentioned.
So if patient is on warfarin and INR is less than 1.5,
yeah.
Can we go ahead immediately with surgery? Or should we stop warfarin for 5 days and then can go ahead with surgery?
What it means is that the patient, when the patient is on warfarin, the INR should be ideally be between 2
ideally
and 3.
Ideally, it should be higher.
Between 2 and 3.
We come across some patient where INR is around 1.5 or less than 1.5.
In case, an emergency, there should be no harm in going ahead.
Not
if the INR is less than 1.5, we have to be sure about the lab. I mean, there should not be a lab error because the whole thing depends on the amount of sample. The design is very critical. How much sample should be sent to the lab? If there are mistakes in sending that sample size is wrong, then the results can be wrong. So if you are going ahead with a planned surgery where the INR is normal and the patient has taken warfarin even yesterday, I think it is better to repeat it once more if you want to go ahead with surgery.
What it means is that the reason of why the patient on warfarin is very important. Probably the patient will be having a lot of thrombi on the valve or whatever problem that he has. So it's very important that it has to be reconfirmed.
And if
dangerous.
Emergency surgery, we can definitely
but we come across such INR more often.
Because many times it can be because the patient is not resorting to the... the patient is not very regular in taking the medication.
Patient compliance is not good.
In that case, it is safe. But the lab error has to be ruled out.
Patient is on clopidogrel or aspirin. So, what is the best possible we can do?
I just mentioned for aspirin.
If the patient is on clopidogrel, patient is having a hip fracture, a fracture neck of femur, and the patient is having comorbidities wherein GI is little risky. So can we do a single shot spinal even if the patient is on clopidogrel? Because as you said, the
it will be risky. The incidence, you shouldn't be the one patient out of those 30,000 that I mentioned.
Owing to the benefits and risk, can we do a single shot spinal?
It will be a little safer compared to putting an epidural, definitely.
Yeah, and one more this
problem comes usually many times comes
actually,
across.
Actually, what is the most important thing is you have to evaluate the risks involved in both,
exactly.
You see. And it is the patient's choice. Because ideally, as per guidelines, if the patient is receiving clopidab, even single shot spinal is not free of neuraxial hematoma. But people like Dr. Balavenkat, who is an authority in regional anesthesia, he has delivered lectures where he has given single shot spinals for so many patients who are on antiplatelet agents. But that all actually depends on how fine you are in your administration, and you have to hope that there is no blood clot. So if it depends on where you are working, what is the rapport with the patient, with the surgeon,
explain the patient regarding the complications, benefit risk ratio.
So I think it is the patient's life, so you have to discuss with the patient, with the surgeon, yeah. And you have to weigh between the lesser risk and go ahead.
And if the patient is on a stent,
and of course, postoperative monitoring is very important, because neuraxial hematoma, if it develops, if you diagnose it early, then only there are some chances of recovery.
As I mentioned, the first 8 hours are very crucial. Only if in the 8 hours, if your patient is on epidural, you are already giving some analgesic. So if the patient is unable to, it's very difficult to diagnose paraparesis followed by paraplegia in that first 8 hours, because the patient is usually taking some high drug of either bupivacaine or opicaine, whatever is going on. That's why that critical thing is diagnosing, most important.
Yeah, and the patient is on drug-eluting stents. What is the time limit for you to stop if it is a elective surgery? Mm-hmm. I mean, how much?
For drug-eluting stents, they say first 6 months you should preferably not take the patient up for any elective surgery. For drug-eluting stents.
For the drug-eluting stents, actually, there is a risk in stopping the antiplatelet agents because there are higher chances of stent thrombosis.
Stent thrombosis.
Because surgery itself is a procoagulant condition. So if the patient has got a drug-eluting stent placed within less than 1 year, then it is better that if the surgery is not an emergency one, it should be deferred.
Is it 6 months
else,
or 1 year?
It is 1 year. It is 1 year. 9 months to 12 months, actually, to be precise.
Yeah, or we can do a bridging therapy.
Yeah, of course. If you have
bridging therapy... Bridging is very safe.
Yes.
Bridging
if you have drugs like tirofiban, then you can definitely switch over to the shorter acting agents and you can take up the patient for surgery. But I think tirofiban availability is not so.
Exactly,
this thing,
madam.
It is quite costly.
Most of the newer drugs are usually still not available, I mean.
I have one question. Medically, what is better? Patient on clopidogrel, stop clopidogrel for 7 days, go and use fiber. Or surgeon saying, I want to take a patient on the second day, I'll give GA and go ahead with surgery.
Going ahead with surgery is okay. Medico-legally safe. Medico-legally safe. Yes, yes. Yes. Of that case, that will be interesting, I think, to the audience. Can you give a mic, please?
Yes, mic is here, ma'am. You can come forward, madam.
Because you see, these are the case reports which are teaching us a lot, you see. That's why I requested her to come out with
the
details.
He was a 78 years old male, who was a hypertensive, had Parkinson's disease, had a CAD or something, and he was on the primary prophylaxis, and he has had a hip fracture. So what we were thinking is he had COPD and other issues, and we were a little bit hesitant, and the drug history was also not known, because none of the relatives were there, and we went ahead and gave a spinal without knowing that the patient is on clopidogrel.
Okay.
And in the post-operative period, for the first 2 days, he was all right, but he was on... once the drug list came, we knew that he was on clopidogrel. He was on diuretics as well. What happened, they tried to mobilize the patient, and on the second post-op day, he had some altered orientation, all those things. probably then we have a CT in the hospital. Then we had to mobilize him for CT. Then we had a subdural hematoma. It worsened and the GCS came to 5 or 15 and we had to do a CT. And then we found out he had a epidural hematoma. And we have had another case of...
He had also...
Epidural or... Epidural?
No, it was subdural.
Subdural.
Subdural. You said epidural. Intracranial, no? Intracranial.
Intracranial.
Yeah, did the patient require surgery?
We had to take up for surgery. And the thing is, the neurosurgeon was telling, because of dehydration, sometimes
yes,
the bleeding veins
yes.
can give up. So this, we need to be a little bit careful.
Actually, this is also known in pregnant patients.
I wanted to mention there is
a pull on the fax and there can be a hematoma
it's
formation.
Not only about epidural hematoma.
So that's what I said, okay, you have to weigh between the risks and you have to discuss with the surgeon and the patient.
Sir, you mentioned about low-risk procedures, intermediate-risk procedure, and high-risk procedures.
Yeah.
So does it mean if the procedure is low or intermediate risk, the guidelines can be relaxed?
A little bit.
Like
even the guidelines that I mentioned, see, like heparin 2 to 24 hours. The two hours stoppage is for low-risk procedures. But if it's a high-risk procedure, it's better to wait for 24 hours. 24. That way.
You mentioned about reversal of the...
Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
Yeah. It has been mentioned in the literature that reversal of anticoagulation just for induction of the regional block is not advocated.
Yeah.
Only when you think that regional, like for example, you want to do it for pain procedure, where that is the primary therapy that the patient has been posted for. In that also, it can be deferred till you withdraw the drug and then take up the patient. But reversal of anticoagulation is not justifiable to just enable us to give a regional block.
I mentioned the reversal just to let people know that this is what is being found. And in case of an emergency surgery, not just interventional procedure, emergency surgery, then you are in a fix many times. Then you have to think of those that way.
Yes. GA will be riskier than the reversal of anticoagulation.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for that active discussion to all the audience also. Thank you, Dr. Pankaj.